coming to you from Christian Church International, Sultan Hamoud. You are most welcome to this program of the Word. After this, you'll be able to get this message on YouTube and all the other series that we have covered. You can access them at CCI Sultan Hamoud, our YouTube channel. We began a series which is ending on Sunday from 11, and the series is called Positioned for a Season of Productivity. Positioned for a Season of Productivity. Now we are doing part two. We were able to cover properly part one through some introduction. Then I gave you some catalysts, some key catalysts that can lead somebody to productivity, because we believe that what we are doing here, we are helping somebody. God does not waste his anointing. When he speaks a word, it is for a purpose and for a season, and this word must accomplish a purpose. And one purpose that is going to be very sure is for him to make you productive. We saw catalyst number one is wholehearted surrender to the Lordship of Jesus. We did that one in detail. Then number two, we said stay connected to the source. Before I bring number three, I want to do a reading and give some little exposition. Then I'll bring number three of the series, and I declare from the onset that you are called to be productive, and we declare your life shall be fruitful in the name of Jesus. If there was any kind of barrenness, any kind of unproductivity, it is going to come to an end because of the truth that we are exposing you to. Psalm 1, verse 1 to 3. Psalm 1, verse 1 to 3. Blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, or stand in the way of sinners, or sit in the seat of mockers. 2. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. 3. He is like a tree planted by the streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever he does will prosper. Now, we have interest in bearing fruit, and the life of a believer, of a child of God, has been compared to a tree which is planted by the rivers of water, which yields its fruit in season. It does not fail to yield its fruit because of the location where it is located. And the, you know, beside streams of water, that is where it is planted, and it bears fruit in season. I see you, after getting this truth, beginning to bear your fruit in season. When it is time for bearing fruit, it does not fail, neither does its leaf wither. And whatever this person does prospers. I declare to you from today, whatever your heart finds to do shall prosper. And we are saying whatever, not some of the things. When you reach a level of full productivity, that level causes you to be productive, and whatever you do prospers. This is not without some condition, because we have read that person does not walk in the step with the wicked, and that person does not sit in the company of mockers, and that person does not stand on the way of sinners. That is one condition, that this person lives a righteous life. Then condition number two, their delight is in the law of the Lord. They meditate on it day and night. Two things. One, living a righteous life. Number two, taking delight in the law of the Lord and meditating on it day and night. Remember, every promise God gives you, it is a condition that you need to fulfill. For you to fulfill, to receive the fulfillment of this promise of bearing fruit in season, and your leaf never going into the state of withering, and also prospering in everything that you do, there are these conditions. You live a righteous life, and number two, you meditate on his law day and night, and you will show, you will take delight in the same. So I want to get concept number three, catalyst number three. I am calling it pursue righteousness. Pursue righteousness. I have chosen the verb pursue with a reason. Pursue with a reason. So you need to pursue righteousness. Proverbs 15:9. Proverbs 15:9. This is what the Bible says. The Lord detests the way of the wicked, but he loves those who pursue righteousness. I like it that way. The Lord detests, he abhors, he does not entertain it, he does not collaborate with the way of the wicked, but he loves those who pursue righteousness. He loves them. When the Lord begins to love you, I want you to know that you are adding to your state of productivity. When God loves your way, when he is delighted by your conduct of righteousness, then I want you to know that you begin to enter into a new level of productivity. He loves those who pursue, not necessarily those who are called righteous, but those who are putting some deliberate effort to pursue righteousness. You know, there is a time when God watches his child and he gets to know this man is serious, this woman is serious, he is a pursuer, he is pursuing righteousness in his life. Such people find the love of God. May you experience that love, the love of God, in Jesus' name. Being right with God is not by default. You don't wake up and by staying, you begin to experience righteousness. No, righteousness is pursued. You have to pursue it, because the wicked are detested by the law. But those who choose to do it deliberately, to be righteous, to walk rightly before God, such people find his love and they bear fruit. Wickedness is the opposite of righteousness. And we said already, the Lord pursues those who, the Lord loves those who pursue righteousness. Jeremiah 17, 7 to 8. Jeremiah 17, 7 to 8. But blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord, whose confidence is in him. Verse 8. He will be like a tree planted by the water that sends out its root by the stream. Hear that. You are compared. This metaphor compares you with a tree which sends out its roots. In sending out roots, there is some work which is happening. Somebody is making an attempt to feed from the deep waters, to feed from the best soil. You know, the Christian is going deeper, deeper in the faith. If it was just a matter of being beside a river, then it is not automatically that somebody is going to bear. You can be planted in a very good place, in a nice church, with a good pastor, but you need to look for a way of sending your roots into the waters so that you can receive your fruit in the name of Jesus. It does not fear when it comes. I am reading Jeremiah 17, 8. That tree does not fear when it comes. When things go bad, such a tree is not anxious. May you reach a level where you are not anxious. You don't fear anything. Even when it is dry, you have an assurance. You know yourself well that you must bear fruit. Its leaves are always green. May you be like that in Jesus' name. It has no worries in a year of drought and never fails to bear fruit. It never, never fails because, one, it is well planted. The planting of the Lord. And number two, the roots are deep. May the Lord help us to become better in Jesus' mighty name. Now, there are measures that you need to take and remain on track personally, because faith needs to be perfected through righteousness. Number A, understand that righteousness belongs to Jesus. Righteousness belongs to Jesus. It may sound simple, yet very profound. Sometimes we find that our sinful nature does not please God. And mostly our sins cannot be cured except through Jesus. Jesus became our Redeemer and the only one who can redeem us, according to 2 Corinthians 5, 21. God made him who had no sin to be sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. That is what NIV says. He made him, the one who had no sin, to become sin for us. The source of our righteousness is Jesus Christ. Why did he do that? So that in him we might become the righteousness of God. And I know you understand, and you need to know that through Jesus you became the righteousness of God. That is why in Jeremiah 23:6, KJV says that the Lord our righteousness, the Lord our righteousness, part B of that verse, the Lord our righteousness. Some people say nobody can be righteous. Can I say that through the justification of Jesus, we became righteous by the grace of God? And there is no other righteousness, not even religion. Some people think by going to church, by being in a big denomination, by being baptized, they can be righteous. No, there is no other source. Our source of righteousness is Jesus, because elsewhere in Isaiah 64:6, the Bible says our righteousness is like filthy rags. It is not viable, because already we were unclean, and the only way to come out of it is by believing in Jesus so that we can be righteous. And our keen desire, as I want to say, should be to pursue Christ. What is to pursue Christ? Is to have his character. Righteousness is having the character of Christ. Some people want to bear fruit. They want to take a prophetic word and become theirs, but they are not pursuing the character of Jesus. In Acts 11:26, the disciples were called Christians because they were like Christ. The Bible says the disciples were called Christians first in Antioch, where they were seen that they were like the Savior. They looked like Jesus. When he sees that evidence of that believer who is pursuing the character of Christ, he converts them to make them fruit bearers. I pray for you today that your life shall bear fruit. The difference between people is the character they depict. Some depict the character of Christ, others do not have the character of Christ. We work at every day with the goal of seeing its true perfection into righteousness. That is what we are seeking. That's why you see in Matthew 6:33, the Bible says, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and its righteousness." There is one thing you can't do without. You can't do without the righteousness of Christ. And the Bible says, "And all these things will be added unto you." That is fruitfulness. You sought the kingdom. You sought the righteousness. Now, the other things, including bearing fruit, will become your portion. You might be asking me, how do I now receive my miracles? Seek first the kingdom and its righteousness, and all the other things will be added unto you. I'm still on righteousness, and number B of the same is that righteousness means growing closer to Jesus. The first one was to understand that righteousness belongs to Jesus. Then number two, or number B, righteousness means growing closer to him. We can't pursue righteousness alone. Whom do we need? We need the help of the Lord. Number one, seek his presence. Seek his presence. In fruit bearing, we need to be in the presence of the Lord. That is very important. When you walk with his presence, wherever you go, whatever you do, whatever you touch, it comes with a difference. But when you are alone, you are doing it alone, you may never see influence. Influence is brought by the presence of the Lord. Pastors like me require the presence of God. Worshippers and worship leaders require the presence of God. Ministers of the gospel require the presence of the Lord. The presence of the Lord is everything. You need to seek His presence. As you walk in His presence, fruit is going to pursue you. You shall be productive. Psalm 84, verse 1 to 2. Psalm 84, verse 1 to 2. The Bible says, how lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord Almighty. When you are dwelling in His presence, the psalmist is asking, how lovely is that place in His presence? Number 2, 84:2, my soul yearns, even faint, for the courts of the Lord, where the Lord lives. You know, His heart was yearning for that place. My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God. This is the most powerful prayer I have never seen. The psalmist yearning for the courts of the Lord. His heart and his flesh, even his body, emotions, were yearning for the presence of the Lord. Number 2, in the same, walk in the Spirit. Walk in the Spirit. Apart from His presence, you need to walk led by the Spirit of the Lord. There is no better scripture to compare the flesh, the fruit of the flesh, and the fruit of the Spirit, like Galatians 5:22-23. It is very well separated. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, fruitfulness. 20:23. Gentleness and self-control. Against such things there is no law. These are elements of the fruit. Take me again to 22. You know, all these are elements. When you walk in the Spirit, you are full of love. You are full of joy. Peace is your portion. Patience is your portion. Kindness is your portion. Even goodness and faithfulness. And in number 23, the Bible says again, gentleness and self-control. That is the fruit of the Spirit of the Lord. Number 3, invite wisdom. Invite wisdom. We say righteousness means growing closer, seek His presence, walk in the Spirit, invite wisdom. James 1:5. God places great value on wisdom, so much that He wants us to ask for it. If any one of you lacks wisdom, he should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to him. Wise people bear fruit. Number 4 of the same, be generous. Galatians 6:10. Generosity definitely leads to fruit, because you harvest what you plant. What you sow in generosity leads to your productivity. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all people, especially to those who belong to the family of believers. That is an example of generosity, doing good to those who belong to the house of believers. There was number A, understand righteousness belongs to Jesus. Then B, righteousness means growing closer to Him. Then number C, make a purposeful effort to pursue righteousness. Make a purposeful effort to pursue righteousness. That means you don't give up. You are consistent. What I know, when you make a decision to pursue righteousness, what happens? There are so many distractions, things which come to hinder you so that you may never bear fruit. That is why we are teaching it, so that you can purpose to pursue it with all your heart. Catalyst number four. Meditate on the word daily. Our reference was the first Psalm, verse 1 to 3. We have dealt with that category of righteousness. Now we go to meditating on the word daily. The psalmist called it the law. We have the law, the word of God. And brethren, this is a secret. This is a secret. And I have purposed in my heart, I will continue to practice this important law. Delight in it day and night. This is not about yoga. I know the Hindus really have their way of meditation in yoga, but I'm talking about Christian meditation, which is fundamentally different from secular meditation. I know we are in the secular world. People will take time to meditate, you know, to unwind. Even some of them relax through meditation. I'm not talking about relaxing. David was talking about meditating in his law, not during the day, not during the night only, but throughout day and night. Whatever you are doing, you'll be led by the Lord. And I want to give you some 7 principles of meditation. The CCI community at Sultan, we are reading the Bible in a marvelous way. I want us now to move to another level of meditation. The 7 principles. Number 1, meditation is a contemplation of God. Meditation is a contemplation of God, comma, a practice of silent reflection. A contemplation of God, a practice of silent reflection with a great reward. I can't miss the last one. With a great reward. You are contemplating of God. You are in a practice of silent reflection. You look at the law, you reflect on the law. But I want you to know it is a reward. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 31. But those who hope in the Lord, some other translations talk of waiting in the Lord, will renew their strength. That waiting, that hoping was on meditation. These are the results, the rewards. They will soar on their wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. Church, this is a word of meditation. Some people keep on asking, how do you manage? How are you managing to do all these things? Why are you not exhausted? Why are you not running dry? Why are you not having a burnout? When you make meditation a central activity in your life, it has a reward, even for us preachers. You can preach and preach until you get a burnout. You get exhausted. Where does your strength come from? So that you may begin to soar like an eagle. You can begin to run and you are not weary. You begin to walk and you are not fainting. The strength comes from meditating on the law of the Lord. Number two. Meditation is an expectant waiting on God. An expectant waiting on God. This is how we bear fruit. You sit and expectantly you wait on God, comma, with a heart that yearns for understanding. With a heart that yearns for understanding. As you sit and reflect, you are waiting on God and your heart is yearning for some understanding. There is something you are looking for. You are looking for the will of God. God, how do you promote people? I want to understand you. I want to know the meaning of love. I want to understand how I need to live, how I need to talk, how to answer my critics, how to behave when things are tough, how to behave when I'm blessed. God, I want to understand. That is what Isaac did one afternoon in Genesis 24, verse 63. He sat with expectation. He sent some messengers to go and hook a wife for him and bring according to the instructions. Isaac went out to the field one evening to meditate. I like this.
Amen.
This man of God, he knew there was need. He never even went to the tent. He never sat in his bedroom. He went to the field one evening to meditate. And look at what he's doing. And as he looked up, that is already expectation, he saw camels approaching. The camels were coming with a wife, Rebecca. They were coming with a foot. He was expecting something to happen. And instead of getting excited, he went to meditate. And there comes Rebecca. Rebecca was brought. And both of them became a fruit for the next generation. I desire this kind of a life. A life of meditation. I have heard people complaining that you know, they are very much idle. I met somebody, a close friend, who told me, I am looking for a way of killing time. I tell you, for Isaac, it was different. He went to meditate in the field and a reward came. May your reward come. May your miracle come through meditation. May the fruit of your meditation be evident. I want somebody to go and practice meditation until they are feeling like calling the fruit meditation. You are feeling like calling your business meditation, your wife meditation, your husband meditation, because you waited somewhere and it came. You feel like writing on your car, this is a product of meditation. Meditation bears fruit. I remember 11 years ago when we were starting ministry in this place, I made it every day 1 hour in the middle of the night to do nothing else but to sit down and meditate. I tell you, I saw the fruit, and I'm seeing the fruit of meditation. May the Lord reward you because of meditation. And for your information, this man Isaac was not a poor man. He was a successful businessman. He would have gone to do business transactions that afternoon, but he chose to go and look up to heaven. I like, as he looked up, he saw camels approaching, and there came his wife. This tells me that meditation can give you anything.
Amen.
A blessing can come through meditation in a way that you don't expect. And I feel that I'm not doing enough teaching. We may need more time to think about this meditation. Principle number 3, meditation is a preparation that ushers us before the King. It can be said in a better way. Meditation is a preparation that ushers us before our King. Before our King. When you wait upon Him, as I say, He comes with a reward. I know we have all the protocols of waiting for a King. Even Esther waited for 6 months, doing facials, doing every kind of beauty on her so that she can present herself before the King. That is one protocol. Other people go to the King through another person. They get a person who knows the King. They go through him. They tell him, pray for me to get an opportunity to go to the King. But I want to confirm to you that meditation is a sure ticket. A very sure ticket that can take you before the King. And when you go before the King, you can ask for anything and you get it. Try this method and you are going to get a reward. Number 4, meditation prepares us for victory. Meditation prepares us for victory. Anybody wanting to be victorious, try meditation. Try it. Meditate. Stay connected for some time, meditating on the law. After Moses departed, Joshua was preparing to lead the over 1 million Israelites to cross over River Jordan and move to Canaan. In Joshua chapter 1, verse 6 to 8, there was a command that God gave him. He never told him, go and train an army. No. He never told him, go and, you know, do other things. Take me to verse 8. He told him, do not let this book of the law depart from your mouth. Leading 1 million people. Some of us have a small family of 3 people. And sometimes you lead that family, it is not easy. Others are pastoring a church of 20, 100, 200. And again, leading that congregation, it is not easy. Some of you are CEOs of companies with an employment of 50 people, but you keep on hopping from retreat to retreat, trying to train your staff on how to manage themselves. But when God wanted 1 million people to cross Jordan and to go to Canaan, He gave Joshua this instruction. Don't let this book of the law depart from your mouth. When we talk about your mouth, is speaking about it. Meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful. I can now see where the success of a leader comes. It comes from meditating on the word and being careful to do everything scripted therein. That way you become successful. I also mind about other schemes, but as you meditate, the Lord is going to take you to new levels of productivity. Number five, meditation precipitates action. It pushes you to begin to act. It precipitates action. When you meditate, there is a push for you to act, to win souls, to invest, to move to a new level, to try another thing, to try another principle. What you meditate on, there is a likelihood and a very high likelihood that you are going to act on it. The thing that you don't spend time thinking about, you are not likely to do it. Definitely, you will have great success. That is why Joshua alone, he conquered 31 kings because of this principle. 31 kings. And Joshua never lost any battle. May God raise somebody here that they will never lose any battle. The basic input was meditation. He conquered 31 kings, even without a qualified army. I saw a writer making a joke analogy, saying that at Gilgal, he circumcised his army days before the battle. They were not even healed, and he was using a black material to circumcise them. But at the same time, he won the battle, which means it was not about the trained army or the strength of the army, but sometimes even some other methods were used, like walking around a wall and praising the Lord, and the walls went down. The victory was based on Joshua 1:8. Number six. Meditation shifts our minds to God's perspective. You need to hear that. Meditation shifts our minds to God's perspective. You begin to see things the way God sees, not the way you see them. Everybody has trouble with the way they saw things, the way they thought things are going to be. Like all the Christians in the world thought that churches will open after 2 weeks. Actually, most of the leaders gave a span of 21 days, and they say we are going to review the matter after 21 days. I wish we knew so that we can plan. Meditation will shift your mind to God's perspective. I really desire to see things the way God sees them. As a preacher, as a businessman, as a professional, as a career woman, it is important for you to see things the way God sees them. Let me surprise you with a certain statistic. Statistics show that 80% of people's thoughts are negative. Sorry for that. 80% of people's thoughts are negative. When you wake up, you begin thinking of negative things. How you won't manage. How the month is going to be so difficult. How people are going to die because of reasons or others. How you won't complete your education course. How your boss hates you. How you will not manage to climb to that ladder which you dreamt about. How you may not live for another 5 years. These are toxic thoughts, negative thoughts, stressful thoughts, diverted thoughts. They are negative. 80%. Even the way people view others, 80% is negative. But a person of meditation, things become different. You will shift your own mind from where it is and you begin to think like God. Can I confirm to the church? God is not negative about his plans. Jeremiah 29:11, his plans are good. There is no negativity in that kind of a plan. His plans are good. And I believe that one of these days, we will be thinking like him. Because the Bible says, we are God with a small g. We were created and endowed a little bit lower than angels. But we can inherit with Jesus Christ. May every negative thought in your life change to be positive in Jesus' name. Somebody say amen. Amen. Now, the last one, number 7. Meditation is a strategic daily focus on the Lord. Meditation is a strategic daily focus on the Lord. Strategic daily focus on the Lord. The only way to focus on God is meditation. And you do it daily. Daily, daily, day in, day out. As we meditate on God's word, wisdom invades our mindsets. How I pray that wisdom may invade our minds. I know that the beginning of wisdom is knowing God. And it gives us victory as we meditate every day. I can't leave you without this quote. Somebody said, the greatest asset of a warrior is not their weapon. The greatest asset of a warrior is not their weapon, but their mind. The greatest asset of a warrior is not their weapon, but their mind. Meditation works on the mind to change it to become different. And I request you to make meditation your new practice and watch the Lord blessing you in every battle. And you will begin to see fruits being born every day of your life. We have covered another 2 points today, 2 catalysts. And one of it was living a righteous life. And number 2 was on the power of meditation. We needed to understand meditation, pursuing righteousness. And number 2, meditating on the word every day. I want to pray for you so that these 2 aspects can become part of you as you continue to thank God. Father God, I pray that you may make the life of every listener today a life that bears fruit, a life of fruitfulness in the name of Jesus. Fruitfulness in their ministry, fruitfulness in their career, fruitfulness in their businesses, fruitfulness in their finances, in owning property. I pray, Jehovah God, that they may begin, one, to pursue righteousness in the right way, and also to meditate on the word of God. I speak a shift of their understanding and their knowledge in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus. And I declare today, Jehovah God, that everybody who has heard this message, they shall bear fruit. Let them connect by faith to this teaching. Let this teaching change the life of a believer to make them better vessels as Jehovah God, they continue to bear fruit. Let the youth bear fruit, the women bear fruit, the men bear fruit, even our little children, let them bear fruit in the name of Jesus. Every minister of the word, grant them to be fruitful in their ministries, oh God. We thank you and we honor you. In Jesus' name, I do pray and believe. Amen. Amen. We are not yet done. We are going to say a benediction prayer after we do one song. And in the middle of that, you can be giving your offering. We have an M-Pesa number, 0726-285-695. Be generous is a way of bearing fruit. Generosity is a key to fruitfulness. We also have a tail number, 518-7143. 518-7143, M-Pesa number, 0726-285-695. Welcome to this presentation. I'm coming back to say the benediction. Thank you for watching. Stay tuned until the end. God bless you.
Not to give up, but be a fool.